This is part four of a six-part series on A Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life by Shanti Deva. Geshe la za geshe. Okay. We began this trip in Miami, his trip from Dharamsala to the United States this year, where, amongst other very important things, Geshe la was given permission to drive a yacht. Can you imagine this? And it was specifically given the instructions of, there's a bridge over there with some pilings, and your job is not to wreck my yacht, but to go between those pilings. And so, amongst his other accomplishments, he is a pilot of yachts. In Miami, he spoke to the university. He spoke to small children. And middle school children. This weekend, the past few days, we just returned from Boston, where Geshe La spoke to groups there that included a variety of people. And in particular, a scholar from Harvard spent some time videotaping him and covering two areas. One was his involvement in bringing back to life the Bodang tradition, and the other was going through a listing of his current humanitarian works and charitable projects. What, Carol? Oh, that's a good point. In Miami, another one of the things he did was a large group of doctors and their staffs showed up to hear a talk about burnout and how to help heal the healer, and how to deal with difficult patients. He also spoke to a parents group there on compassionate parenting, the theme of which was, so you all think you're being compassionate to your children, but let's analyze that in some detail. So in any event, as to Geshe La's charitable projects, I want to repeat one more time. Tibetan Buddhist Charitable Aid, or TBCA, exists for the sole purpose of funding Geshe La's projects. If you want any further information about those projects or want to make a donation to them, just see Carol, who's seated here in the front at the end. Or for those of you who are watching in video land, just go to BuddhistCharity.org. Yes.
I forgot one thing about
it's yours.
Hi, streamers. If you would like to ask a question to Geshe La, you can ask it at tibethousestreaming@gmail.com. tibethousestreaming@gmail.com. Thanks.
Tene yene ni mo re nyen nam chi ya den de ba yi tu yen de ju je le me ya ba ta me su yin ro bo chi yin.
Tujewa I don't know whether we need or I will be able to recapitulate all the things. And also today we have quite a lot of things to cover. And then this chapter of meditation or single-pointed meditation is a really vast chapter. But anyhow, we need to have a good motivation why we are listening to this, okay, why I'm giving this teaching. just I think few minutes ago, I was talking with one of our friends how to perceive someone as a spiritual teacher. And we have been talking, and then I told her that just listening teaching, okay, just in the beginning you just can listen teaching like you are attending a class, okay, or lecture, and try to examine, and then of course in Buddhist way, we don't accept someone as a spiritual teacher easily, you see, because this is a really very important thing. In the same way as I explained about the meditation, some people think meditation is really easy, but actually it is a very serious thing. Why? Because meditation means we are on the process of changing our mind, you see. If it is mistaken or misled, it can cause a lot of problem, you see. So therefore, we really have to learn what you want to meditate. You have to learn thoroughly, collect the information, if possible, correctly, okay? And read a reliable book. And then also relate with the spiritual teacher. And maybe not so difficult to find a spiritual teacher. But then it's also difficult to find a very good spiritual teacher, you see. And in Tibetan tradition, to choose or to make a decision to perceive some certain person as a spiritual teacher is very difficult in Tibetan tradition. And therefore, you don't have to perceive me as a spiritual teacher. Just learn from me, okay? Just learn, and then you read the book. And then you just search, okay. In the beginning, we just listening, teaching, or talk as a friend. And then slowly, slowly, okay, if you really feel very, very good, okay, good, then you collect the information behind, okay, behind what we talk today. You collect all the information. And then slowly, slowly, you, inside you, you will build us like a faith or trust, okay. I really like to rely on this teacher. And then, of course, this is you can accept someone as a spiritual teacher. When someone is accepted as a spiritual teacher, this is a big obligation. And then to break or to criticize is really very bad, you see. And so therefore, in the beginning, you don't have to hurry to get a spiritual teacher, but just to take time and examine, okay? If possible, there are teachers, I think teachers' quality is also ten qualities, okay? 10 qualities. And I'm relying, okay, when I have to choose a teacher, I rely on the last two, okay? Last two. If all the 10 qualities are there, of course, perfect. If not, at least like more like 7 or 6, okay? If not, the last two are very important. Now, Tsewe tangyi means teacher has to be very compassionate. And teacher has to be a person who is never get tired of helping their disciple. Okay? Always like wanted to help, either today or tomorrow or whenever, okay? Ever ready to help and think. And they don't say that, oh, I'm tired. Oh, this is very stupid, I'm not so happy. Never like this, you see. So these two qualities are very important. And therefore, because this time, just we are almost like we are giving lecture, you see. I'm trying, from my perspective, I'm trying to give a talk which you can also practice in your life, apply in your life. But then, whether you take this as like a to be practiced or not is totally up to you, okay? And definitely you don't have to accept me as a spiritual teacher. That is 100% sure. You don't have to accept me as a spiritual teacher. But listening few days, far not enough. Just listen, study, and if you find it's good, then slowly, slowly you can. So now this chapter 8, I think we don't need to go from the beginning. I think so. I think we go direct. Chapter 8 is, in some translation they say chapter 8 is meditation, chapter of meditation. And in another translation they say meditative state of concentration. And in Tibetan, we say samdenjiliwu, okay? It is definitely related with the single-pointed meditation. Yeah. Just simply meditation is not enough. So it's samden is samden or shine or tingezi, there are few words, okay? Samden is mainly, okay, we say it's focus on single-pointed meditation. And I think we'll not go this. We used to, when we study Panchaparamita, and there's a chapter which is called Samsuk. Samsuk, Sam is like a Samdhya Thangbunyiva Sumba, that means form realm. And then Suk is Sukme, okay, this is formless realms, okay. And we study about this. Very abstract, and of course I was not so interested in this this subject, but we do debate, okay, we have to debate. Because I think that this is something like which is not within us, and so of course we will talk a little bit of this today. And so the term samdhi is coming from that chapter, topic in Panchaparamita. Very complicated, very, very, very complicated. Yeah, very complicated. That chapter was very complicated. So many things to count, okay. And then, yeah, it's really complicated. So, Then, okay. The motivation, okay, to listen to this chapter is really I wanted to train my mind, okay? Okay, because this chapter talks a lot about to how to reduce the gross level of destructive emotions, okay? Gross level of destructive emotions. Subtle level of destructive emotion or imprints, okay, imprints. These are maybe a little later when this single point meditation and this ninth chapter, which is wisdom, if they combine together, and then of course we have to talk a lot about the subtle imprints and all these things, okay? Now, shine rabdu dembel hagdong nyumon namba zomba shejane, thoma shine zelja diyani, this is, I think, one of the central text in this chapter. And it's also connected with the ninth chapter. Shine is this chapter, and then Lakdong is like mostly like wisdom, which is ninth chapter. These two has to play together, you see. And single-pointed meditation and then wisdom, if they come together and then penetrate, they use as a term which is penetrate, means then it can go very deep. And then this has a potential to remove very subtle sort of obscurations, you see. So we are talking only about eighth chapter, which is either meditation or meditative state of single-pointed or concentration. Shine rabdu tenpa lakdong ki, nyomo nambar choba shechen, up to this, okay, shine rabdu tenpa lakdong ki. So now you know, when I talk about meditation, we say meditation is a mind training. Meditation is a mind training, okay? Mind training. Giving training to the mind. Because our mind is at present, okay? At present, our mind is not that good, you see? Maybe, I don't know you, but just in my case, okay, my mind is really hopeless. So I have to give training to my mind, okay? If my mind is very, very cruel, full of hatred, of course, I have to try to do meditation on tolerance or compassion. If my mind is very stupid, then maybe I have to try to develop wisdom or intelligence, okay? So, therefore, first thing is we have to see the weakness of our mind. And then what makes our mind very weak, very disturbed? Or sometimes I can say restless, okay? Our mind becomes so restless. And sometimes our mind becomes so sleepy, so unclear. And if there's something to do today, we always say, okay, I can do tomorrow. Why not today? No, I don't have mood to do today. It has to be done tomorrow, okay? Yesterday we were talking about a scripture to read. And then I asked, okay, oh, you can ask at any time, but not today. So we just go on doing like this because there's in the mind, there's some sort of heaviness. Sleepy, drowsy, lazy, and not so functional, and reluctant to do something. So all these are the very bad factor of the mind. So remove this, we have to do some meditation, you see. If it's a physical thing, of course, we can do some yoga like this, okay? But it's a mental factor, so this will not help. So mind has to be trained. And then also, this text says, our mind is really restless, okay? Distracted to different issues, okay? Different issues, okay? Yeah. So that also is very bad. Because the main aim is that we really have to bring the whole potential of the mind into one focus. And then if we try, we will achieve something. If our mind goes a little bit this side, a little bit this side, a lot of sleeping like this, and then the potential of the mind is diverted, you see. Even we read a book, if our mind is totally focused, fully focused and vigilant and wise, we get a lot of information. If our mind is a little bit sleepy and half going to the supermarket like this, even we read book, at the end, we will not learn so much, you see. Maybe a few points, okay. Sometimes we think, oh, what I was reading? Oh, I forgot what I was reading. After reading about 1 hour, oh, what I was reading? It happens, you see. Of course, 1 hour is a little bit too much, maybe. So therefore, our mind needs a training. Okay, our mind needs a training. The training is two. Okay, two training. One is that our mind is not focused. Okay, restless, going everywhere. For that, we have to give a training to be more focused. More focused. Okay, and that is called meditative state of concentration or single-pointed. Okay, and this is what now the eighth chapter is teaching. And then another meditation is to make our mind more sharp. Okay, sharp, wise. And that is like almost like the ninth chapter, to develop wisdom. And wisdom is not possible to develop by praying, okay, just praying, please give me wisdom. Please give me a package of very nice brand wisdom. Not possible, no. Only is possible if we really analyze what is really true, what is wrong, what is right. So we have to analyze, you see, using our whole intelligence. More we analyze, more study, analyze, our mind becomes more sharp. We'll find more reason, logics. And then our thinking becomes more rational, you see. And if we go on doing this, and then we'll become a little bit less stupid, less wise, more wiser, okay? It's not easy, okay? When I explain it, finish within 10 minutes. But to develop wisdom, it takes a lot of time. But it's so good, okay? It's really, really good. If we really achieve our mind not distracted and not sleepy dozy, just remain on the object, really single-pointed, of course it's very good. And these days some people do just simply a meditation on mindfulness, okay? And every day they do like 1 hour or 30 minutes every day. It makes difference, you see. If we achieve single-pointed meditation, much better. Much, much better, you see. So therefore, training, we are only two, okay? Therefore, when you say meditation, I will say, okay, there's only two meditation, I will say. There's single-pointed meditation and analytical meditation. Yeah, single-pointed meditation is to bring the mind, okay, if the mind is restless, to bring the mind into focus, okay? If the mind is very sleepy, again we have to bring the mind awake and bring into the object. Two obstacles, okay? Laxity and excitement, okay? Through this, we can achieve single-point meditation. And then if our mind is not very sharp or clever or wise, and then analyze, okay? In the beginning, our analyzing power is very, maybe not so good. Slowly go on trying, then we become better. In this way, we become wise. Ultimately, then we will be able to understand the ultimate truth, you see. Ultimate truth of any phenomena. And then that is the maximum wisdom we can cultivate. So then, at the end, together, this single-pointed meditation and this wisdom, if we practice together, and this has a potential to remove any types of contaminations, okay? Whether in the subtle level or in the gross level. The main aim is to be free from suffering and sources of suffering. And then there's, to be free from suffering and source of suffering, first, I think we say it's very important to understand the suffering. And then we really have to try to search the sources of the suffering. And then we try to fight or try to remove or stop accumulating sources of the suffering. If we stop accumulating sources of suffering, then we will not suffer, you see. There are some sources can be like a factor to be suffer in old age. There are certain sort of factor which can be like bring a lot of disease, or there are certain factors which can bring a lot of conflict or fighting situation like this. So all these sources of the suffering, in Buddhism we say these sources of suffering are destructive emotions, okay? And normally we say three poisons, okay? Anger, attachment, and ignorance. These three are the main source of the suffering. If we are able to fight against this and remove, totally remove these things, and then we will not suffer anymore. Okay. So Buddha was trying to find this solution. He did a lot of meditation. And ultimately, he found the answer saying that whatever we are suffering now, this is already on our body. Now we don't want to suffer like this again. Therefore, we have to search a solution so that we will be not born in the same way and we will not suffer old age, disease, all these things in future. Therefore, and he tried to find the source and he found destructive emotion. And destructive emotion, because of destructive emotion, we earn bad karma and together and we'll suffer. So if we stop this and then in future, okay, we will not be suffered by old age or death or disease. So that is how the Buddhist teaching goes in short. So therefore, today we are talking quite a lot about the object, okay, where object where we generate and grow or destructive emotions, okay? And then if we try to analyze the object, okay, whether it is really the object to be totally attracted, okay, attracted, is it really true or not? Am I mistaken, or is it really true that, oh, that object is so good, so good. Wow, this is so good, okay. Oh, I have so much attachment. Is there any object which is really attractive? Or I made a mistake. I was not so clear. I was a bit stupid. Because of this, I saw it very attractive. But actually, if we just try to analyze, there's nothing attractive. And through this, we can slow down or decrease the attraction or desire, strong desire. If we are so angry with some object, okay, like angry, if we search, okay, where is the main factor? Where then we, if we go on searching, we don't find anywhere, you see. That person is a little bit responsible, that person is a little bit responsible, this is a little bit responsible. And that person, we say, okay, he is the only one who made all this problem, you will not find anything. And then slowly, slowly, anger goes down. So here, it's talking in this way, okay. Therefore, ultimate goal is to remove all the destructive emotions, and by removing destructive emotion, and all the bad karma will be stopped, okay, automatically. That is the ultimate goal. For that, we need two weapons, okay? Single-pointed weapon and wisdom, which we can say is ultimate wisdom, okay? Ultimate wisdom, these two. Among these two, which one is first? First, we have to develop this. And then we develop this. And finally, we practice this together. And the best weapon, the best weapon, okay, there's no other weapon better than this. Shine Rabdu Temple, Hagdong, Shine is single point meditation. Hagdong is more insight, okay, wisdom. Shine Rabdu Temple, Hagdong, Nyumon number Jumba Shizen. A destructive emotion can be eradicated, okay? Nyumon number Jumba Shizen. Thoma Shine Zeja, first we have to develop the single point meditation. Thoma Shine Zeja. Teyangni Jigden Chakba Malangunga Jumba Zeja. How to achieve single point meditation? Then we have to try to analyze where our mind is distracted, okay? Either by attachment to a certain object, or angry with some, or jealous with, or ego, or not knowing the things in truth, okay? Through these destructive emotions, and we suffer. Therefore, to stop this, and first we have to develop single-pointed meditation. Now, I think some practical examples, okay? once I was discussing with the once I was discussing about drugs to a young boy who was drug addict, okay? And he was in a drug rehab center as going through a practice, try to be free from drugs, okay? And he was not free at that time. He was not free. And then I was asking, okay? So I really don't have any experience about the drug. How do you feel? Okay, what was your experience? Just tell me. And when, as soon as I asked this in a very friendly way, he was so awakened. He said, yeah, okay. He was so happy to explain. That shows that mind goes there. Mind goes to the drug. Okay, and he just get an experience. Okay, just get, oh, that was so good. Okay, mind goes there, okay? Mind is attracted by drugs. And then just recently, I had a very, very gentle talk. There was another man also. I was talking with a lady who was alcoholic, very heavy alcoholic, okay? His husband ran away with the two children, left her, okay? And she was so difficult to make her free from alcohol. Okay? And then again, I was talking about this a little bit. So we really wanted to train you to be a good resource person. Because now you have quite a lot of experience. And if you are free from there, and you can share your experience as an alcoholic, and so this. And then in the beginning, okay. At a time, almost like I was encouraging her to take alcohol. And her mind went so far. So if we check from there, and also in ordinary these days, like some good, delicious food also makes our mind go there. In Tibetan, we have momo, isn't it? We have momo. Today we had momo. So, and then if we hear momo, and we start to say, because our mind had already gone to momo, you see. Momo was so attractive. Almost like chewing the momo, you see. Swelling. And then we recollect, okay, oh, I had one momo there, it was so good. And then I had momo there, and that was so good. Oh, no. And then here, the momos, how is the momo? Oh, they are very good. Oh, now I really have to have momo. So all our mind is going to momo. And this is the problem for us, you see, problem that we are unable to focus, okay? We are unable to focus. Why? Because of our desire, okay, desire. desire, okay? And then Opus Sendi Deva talks a lot about the attachment between men to women and women to men, you see, which is very difficult to detach. Yeah, so and then he also put some examples, say that if they don't get the women whom that person love deeply, someday they kill themselves. Or they do many bad things, you see, destructive things. Or they break something, okay? Why? Oh, why? Who is playing this important role? Who's leading that person to kill or to break that, okay? To fight, criticize, shout. Some people become mad, you see. Who is leading these activities, beautiful activities? Who's leading? Yeah, destructive emotions, especially the attachment, desire. And then when the desire is just goes this, if it doesn't succeed, it goes against this, then get angry or jealousy, you see. So therefore, great spiritual teacher, Shantideva talks, okay, without, in the beginning, slow down all these things, and slowly, slowly, try to make them sleep. Try to make them sleep, okay, by cultivating single-pointed meditation. Okay, single-pointed meditation. I think we go up to this, not more, I think. I think this is okay. But then single-pointed meditation can like reduce, and slowly, slowly, it can make like the all these destructive emotions like become like imprints, okay? But it cannot remove forever. Why? Because to remove any types of destructive emotion or its imprint need wisdom and single-point meditation together. Then only it can remove, you see. Jigde Chapa Melam Gyunga Dup. I'm explaining about Jigde Chapa Melam Gyunga Dup. Jigde Chapa is like a gross level of attachment, okay, attachment. So now he also analyzed, okay. Yeah, if we see a very handsome man, okay. Oh, he's so handsome. Ooh. So handsome. I have never seen such a handsome boy or man in my life. He was so handsome, okay. So handsome, okay. Oh, if I get a chance to kiss him or hug him, oh, I will be in heaven. But then, now we have to analyze, okay, is it really true? Is it really true? And then you see that person is very clean, very beautiful, and everything is like no problem to touch or, you see, okay? But then in reality, what is coming out of that body, is there anything which we can say it's very clean? If that person spit here, is it possible to leave? No. Okay? And then something which is coming out of our body, not so, they are not perfume, they are not sandal, they are not very, no. Nothing is eatable, nothing is drinkable. And as soon as it comes out, we say, when it's here, it looks quite okay. So mind is so, no logic. By seeing this, okay, now where is the attraction, okay? Yeah, there is an attraction, okay? And there is an attraction, but where is it, okay? Is it on the nose, or is it on the face, or is it on the body, is it in the hand, or in the eye? In India, there's one lady whose eye is very good, okay? What do you say? And there's some stories, okay? And there are some people who has, now I don't go into detail. Yeah. So we see that person is very clean, okay? And also very attractive. But then, if you go on searching, we don't find that attractive within that sort of body. Instead, we find so many things which we don't like. And which one is right? Which one is right, okay? Conventionally, okay? Which one is right? There's something wrong, okay? There's something wrong. So now, Shantideva is analyzing, because when someone is doing single-pointed meditation, okay, single-pointed meditation, try to achieve single-pointed meditation, and that person sees a very handsome man, okay? And then single-pointed meditation is lost. So the mind goes to the handsome man or beautiful girl, and then even if you sit down or thinking about handsome man and beautiful girl, to remove this, okay, try to remove this, bring your mind back, we have to see whether it is really beautiful and handsome as I perceived. Okay, after analyzing, then you will not find anything there which is so attractive as I perceived, not there. And then from there, and then you can bring, after analyzing, seeing all the truths, and then we will be able to bring our mind back. And then single-point meditation is possible, you see. Otherwise, mind goes everywhere with the momo and what else? Momo and then... and then like clothes, okay. Some clothes and different brand some young people, they wear very, very good brand shoe. There are many funny things, you see. And when I got this iPhone 6 Plus, okay, and I was making phone call in front of many people, okay, so that everybody will see, okay. So that, again, my mind is not on the single-pointed, okay. It's gone. So there are so many distractions. So the point, okay, main point in Shantideva's text is that try to analyze the object. When we get angry with some object, we really have to analyze. Where is the object of the anger? You say, why I'm angry? Why, okay? How am I getting angry? Is it there or is it here? Or in between? Okay. And then if I'm really attracted, oh, where's the beauty? Is it totally there? And I'm really perceiving exactly what is there and nothing addition, nothing wrong? Or is there any something which is not right, you see? And by analyzing this, and then slowly, we really try to learn the truth, okay? Truth, the reality, and then we can bring our mind in the normal sort of situation. Do you get the point? And I'm trying to explain in a living way, okay, just how our minds are attracted, okay? And it is a difficult job. And so for example, in my case, now I'm 69. And my mind has been attracted, okay? Attracted, or my mind was very angry. 69 years, you see. Now to bring this down, change, I'm so get used to it. And I really practice all these bad things, you see, for 69 years. Now to destroy this, to get rid of this is difficult. I'm not discouraging you, okay? You all are much younger than me. And you all look very alert and very... so try, okay? So when you become like my age, I think you will succeed something. Now I'm too late. I'm very, very, yeah. I always say that I was born a little bit too late. And too early. Therefore, I cannot adjust with you. I'm like few decades back. What do you think about this? Yeah. The single-pointed meditation, you must have thought that single-pointed meditation is, I think, focus your mind on this object and just place your mind on this object and meditate. I think you must have expected in this way. But of course, he explains in a different way. How our mind is, how it goes to different objects, especially very attractive and very negative. Neutrals are okay. Because of this very attractive and very negative, within this, our mind goes to this object so strong, almost we have no control. We have no control. And then the definition of single-pointed meditation or meditation is meditative concentration. Okay, I think this is very good. The definition of meditative concentration is called shana yome ri ongpo shi tang na giwe mikpa kuna chung lusim lesu rungwe di jindi tizar shi ne they don't go. So shana yome ri ongpo shi tang na giwe mikpa kuna chung lusim lesu rungwe di jindi. Okay, up to this. Shana yome ri ongpo shi means if we achieve meditative concentration, and then if I put my mind on this object, okay, it stays there like a big mountain, unshakable. Shangna yome ri ongpo shin. Ri ongpo means one of the biggest mountain, okay? Shangna is if I place my mind on this object, it stays on the object totally unshakable, okay? And if I wanted to release this or use this mind to different good things, it goes to all the merits, okay, all the good merits to earn, collect, okay? And then by doing this, will I get tired? No. Instead, it will give so much satisfaction. Physically and mentally, okay? So to achieve this, we have to bring our mind back, make it within our control by achieving meditative concentration, and then we can use this mind for so many good purposes, you see? Good purposes, yeah. Yeah. I think I'm a little bit too fast. I think you understood, isn't it? I think so, yeah. Very easy. Finished, you see. It's a peanut. So now I don't know. Mm. Mm-hmm. Yes?
I have a question. Can you define wisdom?
What?
Can you define wisdom?
Wisdom, I think we can define today, but we have 2 days for wisdom. Yeah. And two wisdoms, okay? The one is conventional wisdom and one is ultimate wisdom. As a general, the mind which knows which is right and which is wrong, which can differentiate the right and wrong. Okay, that is the main function of wisdom. Main function of wisdom is to differentiate right and wrong. Yeah. Sure of the number of now. If we really don't know how to differentiate between good and bad, right and wrong, then we say stupid, you see. If we are able to differentiate good and bad, right and wrong, which is very subjective, but by developing analytical meditation, then it's possible, you see. Yeah. So to develop wisdom, we have to do meditation on analysis. Like this sitting is not enough. We have to search which is right, which is wrong, which is correct, which is all. So we have to analyze, you see, including the mind itself. How is my mind functioning? Is it taking me to the wrong direction? Is it taking me a good direction? Or is it making disaster? Or is it making good contribution? So everything, okay, action, thought, and object. So we have to analyze, okay? What is the real existence of any phenomena? Again, we are analyzing. We are making a lot of mistakes because we really don't know what is the ultimate truth of this thing. Then we are making mistakes, you see. Any issue, if we really know the truth, there will be less conflict, less doubt, less mistake. If we don't analyze, we will not know the truth, and then we make unnecessarily many mistakes, criticize, doubt, and conflict, or so on, you see. So therefore, the wisdom is sub-mind. It is sub-mind. It is not main mind. Sub-mind, which has a potential to differentiate good and bad, right and wrong. Okay. This is a very rough definition. Yeah. If anyone wanted to debate with me, so I will say today no time to escape myself from the debate. I think I didn't touch this. So now, and then again our mind, most of our mind likes praise, isn't it? Praise. You are very good, you are excellent, brilliant, wonderful, outstanding, marvelous. We like these words, so we are so good, you see. If someone says, you are a wonderful person, oh yeah, I'm a wonderful person. That person says, wonderful person, I perceive much more than wonderful, you see. Oh, you are so intelligent. Superficially, I might say, no, I'm not that intelligent. But inside, yes, I think, yeah. So this is also against single-pointed meditation, you see. I really have to know exactly. Yeah. And because this brings our mind not on the level, okay, normal level, it elevates our mind, takes to the Mount Everest. Our mind goes to Mount Everest. And this is not stable. At any time, it can fall down, you see. Everest base camp, okay, it'll go to Everest base camp. And maybe if we're lucky, maybe there we will be intact there. And luckily they break the leg or break the hand. So it is possible. Therefore, prayers also have to be very careful. If you wanted to achieve single point meditation, you should not be so attached to the names and fames. Okay? And then if someone is criticizing very badly, and then also you should not go down to Dead Sea. Dead Sea is very, very low. So, so just remain where you are, okay? Try to see, okay, your state of mind and everything. You just see the truth. And don't run after this, okay? If say someone good, you go good. Someone says bad, you go to bad. And that is one of the causes that we don't get the stability of the mind, you see. So therefore, these are also very bad factor to achieve single pointed meditation. Yeah. And he says that if there's someone who's praising you, why should you be so elevated? Because there are certain people who criticize you. And if someone is criticizing you, why you get so down? Because there are some people who appreciate and praise you. So you have to remain on your level, okay? Very, really stable and realistic. And then having this base and then do meditation, it's possible to achieve single-pointed meditation, okay? If your mind goes up and down every day, 2 times, 10 times, 20 times, and then your mind is totally distracted. Now, it's a little bit different area, okay? And then, I don't know. Some areas, okay, I think, to me, I also received few mails saying that no, this I don't say. So now I say in general. Some people are saying that you suffer a lot because you are so compassionate. Yes? You suffer a lot because you are so compassionate. And you take so much responsibility. Therefore, you get tired. And so you should not be so compassionate, you see. Compassionate brings a lot of problems, suffering. Okay. He asks this question in this text, okay. Ningje dungye mangkyunna. Ya, ningje dungye mangkyunna. Chidan ningje gomshena. And that is the question, okay. That compassion brings a lot of worries, okay. A lot of worries. And a compassionate person has a lot of worries, yes. And then also works very hard. Therefore, some people say, okay, this is totally against the single-pointed meditation. Because it brings worry. And it takes all your energy to work. Well, so therefore, it's not possible to say. And then, now, the answer by Shantideva, you just see. This is a little bit difficult to understand, okay, or accept. He says that, yes, the compassion brings certain sort of worries and suffering, okay, to a person. Okay? But having this compassion, the benefit goes to so many people. So therefore, he says, either this suffering or whatever, okay, this is just nothing. The benefit is like a mountain. And then the pain, worry, having compassion is nothing. So therefore, it will not disturb the single-pointed meditation. Yeah. Which is a little bit difficult, yeah. If you understand, then it's okay, and whether you agree or not, that is not a big problem. So slowly, slowly you practice, then you will agree. Yeah. ninji dunga mangyu chida ninji chana chowe dunga sambana chida ninji chowe dunga sambana chida ninji dunga mang means if we think of the sufferings of so many sentient beings and then by thinking this of course someone get the worry who's very compassionate they get worry but this problem if you put in front of all the sufferings of so many sentient beings then this becomes so small you see and then by having this compassion if that compassion is used for so many people okay and then this worry becomes so insignificant plus it also gives a lot of good energy yeah when I say, no, don't go there. Yeah. Maybe we can have a short break. Yes. And then I don't know whether I should allow you to ask question or not. I'm a little bit afraid of you. Okay.
How long is
that? Maybe 10 seconds? 10 minutes, I think. At least 10 minutes. So I think we start, okay? Yeah. Some easy questions, please. Very, very easy questions. Yeah?
All right.
Is it easy or difficult?
I think it's easy.
Huh?
I think it is easy.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, you've been saying that we need to get rid of the negative emotions or destructive emotions. I've always heard during teachings that it's more about transformation than getting rid of it, eliminating it. Like
yeah, eliminating. Yes.
So it is eliminating.
Yes. Yeah. Is there any disagreement with you?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, remove, I say, remove or eradicate, okay? For example, there are certain sort of destructive emotion, maybe we can use a little bit, but for us it's not easy, so we say remove, yeah, remove. And transform, okay, transform is it's a quite a tricky sort of translation. For example, transform, say, okay, I transform my anger into tolerance. Means I removed my anger and developed tolerance. And that is the transformation, you see. I'm not saying my anger changed into tolerance. No, that is not possible. Yeah, not possible. Yeah. You get? Yeah. Not easy question. Yes. do you get the point? Yeah. So it has to be removed, yes. Yeah. When we say destructive emotion, we say we use antidote, okay? Antidote, and then antidote will fight to the destructive emotion, and it will remove. Yeah. So in the same object, it was very, very angry. By using the antidote tolerance, and then slowly, my way of seeing the object will be less anger, and then anger will go, and then I have a big tolerance towards that object. Yeah, it has to be like this. Yeah. There are some other meanings also, transformation, but I think we live there. Yeah. This is, I think, directly related with your question. Okay? Yeah.
Thank you, Geshe-la. How is love considered in Buddhism? Is it considered a healthy desire, or is it a matter of wishing the other happy and not suffering? How is it thought of?
I think we used this in the first session. We explained that love, okay, we just simply if we use love. In Tibetan, we say chamba. And also, I think in the Sanskrit, also almost the same. And then we have to understand what this love means based on the topic or the context, okay? So now we are, if I say, okay, I'm now on the process of developing love towards every sentient being, okay? And that is like a, either you say universal love or unconditional love, whatever you say, okay, it's a love, but it is not bias because it covers all sentient being, okay? If I say I love my girlfriend, then I love girlfriend, okay? It has its own boundary. And I love, okay? And then I don't have much love to other people, you see? Just love this. Okay, and then that love is also quite biased. Why? Because normally we say, I love from the bottom of my heart, okay? And my love is 100% pure. And it is not, you see? It is really not. If it is 100% pure, and that girl finds a much better boyfriend than myself, then I have to say, welcome, oh, thank you so much, you found a... That is not the case, you see. We get jealousy, we get fight. So this is a sticky, you see, attachment, desire. Therefore, just if we use love, neither is it good nor bad, okay? We have to see what it is really talking, what we are explaining, okay? Now, do you get the point?
When you love someone, that is bias.
Yeah.
That's not universal love. That's not every sentient being.
Yeah.
It has a boundary. I mean,
yeah.
After
condition.
That,
yeah.
A condition.
Yeah. It is. It has condition. You see, because it the love is only conditioned to love only one person. You see.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And is that not a good thing?
It is not healthy.
It's not healthy.
Yeah, it is not healthy. Because this brings, sometimes it brings jealousy, sometimes it brings anger, sometimes it brings, it brings quite a lot of unhealthy things, you see. Yeah.
I see. So love should be towards all sentient beings.
All sentient beings. That is the most healthy thing, you see. Yeah. Then this will not let among the sentient beings to fight, you see.
I see.
So otherwise, if I love only one person, mm-hmm. and I love this person, mm-hmm. and whosoever does something wrong to this person, then I become very angry.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
I see.
No.
Thank you.
Okay. In Israel also, they ask this question. How can you explain about the pure love? And then I explain same, you see. If you have love, if it's really pure and universal, and then I think anybody who achieves much better happiness, I will have no jealousy. I will be very happy, you see. Even my, to whom I call as enemy, if they achieve happiness, still I will be very happy, you see. So if my love is biased, I love Tibetans. And then if someone achieves happiness, then I become a little bit jealous. If the Tibetans achieve happiness, wow, this is very good. And then this is the problem, you see, fighting and all these things, you see. So I hope this is okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Getting back to what you were talking about before the break.
Yeah.
So back to single-pointed meditation.
Yeah.
That's our goal.
Yeah.
And you explained why. Would you explain how and when to develop single-pointed meditation?
Yeah. I explained a little bit like laying the atmosphere, laying the foundation, and creating favorable condition, mentality, all this, okay? When it comes to meditate, to achieve single point meditation, then we have to focus on one object, you see? As the, this is the object, then we just look to this, and then close your eye and get the picture of this book in your mind, and then place your mind on this object, okay? And if in this way, place your mind on this object, place your mind on this object, and then if it goes away from there, place it again, and then try to stay it little longer. So in this way, and then all the nine steps, and these are steps of how to achieve single point meditation. And then here he's talking about the distractions, okay? If we don't remove all these distractions, okay, and even we have this as object, we will not be able to achieve single point meditation. Therefore, he placed more important to remove all these distractions, okay, by analyzing, okay, seeing the reality truth. And then after removing this, if you do meditation, and then it will be very, very successful. So, yeah, and in this way, it is structured. But it has a lot of text. What I touched today is far not enough to say that I taught the 8th chapter. Just I touched only few points. If you say that, oh, Geshe-la taught the 8th chapter, it's not enough. Because there's so many examples. But all these are needed to develop single-pointed meditation. And of course, then itself is a single point, developing single-pointed meditation. But then just by removing all these things, it's not enough. So we have to bring one object to be the object of the single-pointed meditation and then meditate. And all those distractions are already by analyzing, we just say goodbye, okay, don't come here, okay? Now I'm going to think only this object, yeah? Yeah. Yeah.
How does learning how to focus definitely? Oh, I don't know where the microphone is.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry?
There's one question, yeah. Yeah.
I didn't see. I'm sorry.
Okay. So when you were talking about the removal of certain destructive, disturbed emotions, and I guess this is the distractions as well, you talked about anger, attachment, jealousy. I think there are actually three things that you mentioned: anger, attachment, and there's one third one that I missed it. Or is it all?
What?
We talked about contamination of the disturbed emotions.
I took some more. Three poisons.
Yes. So you said anger, attachment, and you said one more thing.
Ignorance. Yeah.
And would jealousy be part of that as well?
Huh?
Would jealousy be part of that as well?
Jealousy is more or less coming together with the attachment. Yeah.
How is it that our learning how to concentrate and focus will help to eliminate these destructive emotions? How does that happen? Why, when I make my mind more focused and more able to concentrate, will these negative emotions start to go away?
Mm-hmm. I think the to frame, for example, if I'm so attached to the taste of the momo, okay, and then I just by thinking this, and then also momo is not a healthy food. It's not a healthy food, you see. Yeah. And then also, if we eat a little bit too excess, then it's really not good. It smells like cock. It smells momo, like whole day. Just a few pieces, okay. But if we eat more, then it's really very bad, momo. And it's not the healthy, especially momola, I don't give momo. Because it's very difficult to digest. I don't know, but it's practically, yes. Practically, I don't give this momo to her. So when we are attached to this, we have to see the negative side effect of the things, you see. If we just think of negative side effect, of negative impact to the mind, thinking this, slowly, slowly, we dislike. And then it minimizes the attachment. Now, here he says that if you are attached to one boy, handsome boy, and if you just think, okay, the thinking that, if you just think in a rough way, oh, very handsome, wow, 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 okay. But if you just think of this, all this covered by a skin, in the skin, there is a bone, flesh, intestine, lung, and there's so many. If you just go on thinking this, and then slowly, slowly, the attachment towards that object slowly, slowly lose, you see, because these are not so attractive, not so. And then if you think of what is coming out of this body, and also not so many interesting things, you see. So, and what is coming from the bottom is also not very good. So not very good. And then we started losing the attachment. Yeah, so, and that is how it functions, you see. Yeah. And then one great teacher in Ganden Monastery, and that I was a bit stupid when he asked this question to me. He asked, oh, how many hermits, meditators in Dharamsala? And I said, I think maybe about 14, I know, okay. We are also supporting a little bit of the, for the expenses of the hermits. 11 or 12 we are supporting, partly, okay. Because of this, I know this. And then he asked me, what they are meditating? And I said, I think they are most of them, I always say that they are meditating on Lamrim, okay, Lamrim, and all this, and then how high they are reached. I said, no, I don't know. I don't know. And then he said, do they do meditation on skeleton? I said, I don't know. I would have asked why. Yeah. If we just say, okay, like say, very beautiful one, okay? And then if we think of the flesh, all this, and then if we think of the skeleton, okay? And then there's not much we can develop attachment, you see? Yeah, yeah. It is just like, at present it's alive, and then all these bones are together, and then fleshes are not in bleeding. So, and then covered with the skin, and then it looks beautiful. And then if you just go really close to this, and you will not find so much sort of like beautiful there, you see. In this way, we have to analyze and think from different perspective, different, what Shantideva was explaining in this way. There was some misunderstanding also, and there was some, what you say, feminist. They were saying that why Shantideva is so bad to the women? Yeah, really, they're asking, really? And then His Holiness answered that I think he was teaching this to a group of monks, you see. Therefore, he's explaining more about the women to be detached, you see. If Shantideva explained in a group of nuns, okay, women, then he will explain more of the man, what is the wrong in the dirtiness in the or the monk, you see. That is understandable, but then people thought that, oh, Shantideva is really biased. Whew! So the, even it's like anger, okay? If you started seeing some good points, if I'm angry with you, I get angry because I saw some mistakes in you, okay? Because this, I get angry. But if I just try to settle down and try to see good qualities of you, and then my anger will go down. Oh, I thought he's totally black, you see. I thought he's so bad that everything he thinks is bad. Everything he speaks is bad. Everything he does is bad. Okay. But actually it's not, you see. He does many good things also. But I saw only one mistake and then I'm making that totally black. And in this way I get angry. Okay. If I say, oh, he has many good qualities. One of the teachers says, yunde kunde kum bata yunde chikya meba kum. Yunde kunde kum bata yunde chikya meba kum means he says, the person who has all the good quality, if you search, is also very rare. And if you search a person who has no good quality, also it's impossible to find. So therefore, more you see the positive side, your mind will get a little less angry. If you see more of the negative side, you get very angry. That shows that there's a possibility of reducing anger, you see. And then we see that person, oh, he has been my mother for many, many times, has been done so many good things. And then he started becoming closer, you see. And anger goes down and become very close friend or close relative or mother. We need to bhavana. In Sanskrit, the bhavana is familiarize. That is the meaning of the meditation in Sanskrit, bhavana, okay? And that means to familiarize. Yeah, to familiarize, okay?
Dear Keshe-la, my question is related to a personal experience. Taking the example of the Momo,
yeah.
In a very quiet moment, I sit on my cushion and I think about the Momo. Mm-hmm. In such a way that it is having a bad effect on my body.
Yeah.
It makes total sense.
Yeah.
Sense.
But, but there's but.
Starting again.
Yeah.
The question is related to a personal experience. So taking the example of your MoMA.
MoMA, yeah.
I sit quietly on my cushion and I think about the MoMA and all the bad quality it has on my body.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes total sense,
yeah.
And I totally agree with, like,
yeah.
I shouldn't eat MoMA.
Uh-huh.
But then I step up and I walk away from the cushion into my daily life.
Yeah.
I know I'm supposed to guard my body, speech, and mind,
yeah.
Constantly to be aware of what I'm doing, what I'm saying, what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
But then I caught myself in the moment, I was thinking for such a long time about the MoMA,
yeah, yeah.
And I'm not guarding my mind in that very moment. I actually even contributed to stimulate myself to actually go and eat the MoMA.
Mm-hmm.
What can I do about that?
And then I think you are not seeing the negative side of the MoMA.
Not in that very moment, because I already was thinking about the MoMA.
When you are practicing.
So there is the MoMA, so I'll take
when
it.
When you are practicing, okay, when you are practicing, and then if you practice this only about 15 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours, that is far not enough. Because your attraction towards MoMA has been like, as I told you, you see, I'm 69 years old. My attachment towards my mother has been 69 years old. So now to detach this, okay, is far not enough. If I do meditation about 1 week, still is not enough. Therefore, the bhavana, as I explained, is bhavana. So if you wanted to detach, or if you reduce your attachment towards MoMA, and you have to work very hard, not only one time, two time, three time, and also have to be very single-pointed, okay? Really very appealing to you. And then slowly, slowly, it will go less and less and less, okay? So one or two times is not enough, yeah.
But you will consider the fact that it is actually stimulating the need for MoMA in the first place.
Now, if you see the taste on the good quality of the MoMA, it stimulates, okay? If you see the bad side effect, then it will not stimulate. If I understood, okay, yeah. Was it a bad answer? You were not so happy with my answer. I will think a better answer, okay?
Well, frankly speaking, I have a problem between... Sorry.
Frankly speaking, my problem is still that the conscious mind, the awakened mind during the meditation, is acknowledging the bad qualities. So therefore, I totally agree with, like, MoMA is a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
But during the moment, I actually see the moment somewhere in the store and I'm not meditating, my subconscious mind is still saying, well, MoMA is tasty, I want that.
And you don't remember anything about your meditation.
Well, that's the thing.
How do
I achieve that?
That need consistency, you see? Yeah. We talk about meditators, the period of the meditation session and period of the post-meditative state, okay? So when you are having post-meditative state, still you have to, if you really want to reduce the attachment towards MoMA, you should not forget. Just don't undress yourself, okay, from the meditation. Just, you are not in the meditative state, but still you have to remember what I have done during the meditation. It has to go. And then again, come back to the meditation. And then also it's very subjective. How long? How effective? And everything has to be counted, you see. And I don't know, because now we are very fresh friend. So I don't know how much you focus, how much you see the good quality of the MoMA, bad quality of the MoMA, how long you have meditated. So therefore, it's very difficult to answer. If your meditation is really, really effective, seeing the bad side of the MoMA, I think it will definitely reduce the attachment towards the MoMA, yeah.
What would you recommend to take the inside of the meditation out into the post part of the meditation?
And that is what we remember, you see. When you become more familiar to the mind, to the detachment of the MoMA, familiarize, okay? If it becomes very familiar, we will not forget, you see. If we just remember only one time, then we might forget. If we use this again and again and again and again, and then it comes into our mind almost like spontaneously, yes. So it totally depends upon how much you practice. I have a lot of experience with my anger, you see. Yeah, I try to... First year, second year, I try to reduce my anger and try to forget the object of the anger, you see. I try to see some good quality there, from there. And then all these big like statements, like they have been my mother, da-da-da-da. But it was quite far, you see. And I did meditation really, really quite hard. After 11 years, I saw some difference. After 11 years, okay, I was quite seriously did meditation to reduce my anger towards certain sort of object, you see. I become blind two times, short-term blind two times because of my anger. And then I did, after 11 years, then I felt that, I think I have a little less anger. Of course, still I get angry, but I felt that I think I have less anger. And it really improved my life, my health, and friendship, and many things. But sometimes it's so invisible. It's a mental factor, you see. We can't see so in a physical sort of type of things. So I think we have to try.
Thank you very much.
As possible, yes.
Thank you very much.
Okay. MoMA is a little bit easy. There are other things which are much more difficult than MoMA, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Hello. Angela. generally, it's quite natural for a man to be attracted to women, right?
Mm-hmm.
What other things that we have to learn in order to detach from that kind of attachment towards women, other than what you have explained about the skin and blood and skeleton that lies underneath the skin? Are there any other important things that we have to know in order to detach that kind of a feeling towards mm-hmm. the opposite mm-hmm. sex? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. if it's just only this area, okay, then he also explains that and also in Nagarjuna's text, he says, "Tawa yuni talk juja, jabe dunge tiveche." So everything is impermanent. Everything is impermanent, and at any moment, okay, we will be not more together. Where there's a gathering, there's always like a departure or separation. And so, according to Buddhism, say that as long as we are together, we will make our life together in the most meaningful way. Instead of like having so much attachment towards each other, we mix, okay, attachment, we think that attachment is a really good thing to each other. But actually, we can do much healthier things that now we love each other. This can be, okay, this can be more of attachment, but then we really wanted to make our life very meaningful. And in the long run, okay, we do some good things, okay? We think some good things, okay? So, but this life is just a short term. Sometimes we plan that, oh, we live many, 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 like think that we will never die. But this should not happen. So I think we are going to depart, okay? And so we have to get these days, like I love my mother. And so I love my mother. Yes, I really love my mother. But I prepared myself that, okay, she's older, okay? She's 96 years old. I'm 69. According to the lifespan, I think she will go faster. But who knows, you see? Who knows? Okay, we don't have any time travel. So we have to get ourselves ready so that this will not live so, so painful, okay? Just get ourselves ready that, okay, at any time we'll be detached or separated. So to prepare this is, as long as you say, oh, now, okay, this will happen sooner or later. So now we really have to use our life in the most meaningful way. Most meaningful way, okay? Supporting each other in a very good way. Try to do so many good things. Think good things. And make each other really happy. And activate so many good things, you see. Thinking that, okay, one day we will be no more together. Yeah. So in this thinking is more, it is also explained here also. Yeah, of course, I didn't cover. And this impermanent, okay, impermanent nature of the things in any sort of phenomena is very, very interesting, very, very good, you see. It gives so much opportunity to us. But being impermanent means it's changeable. It gives a hope that it is changeable, you see. If it's very, very bad, if it's very, very bad, still it is impermanent. It is changeable. See? And so then now say, okay, we are so attached. We don't want to separate each other even the 1 second. We don't want to. But then if you don't really, then this is so difficult, you see. It caused a lot of problems, suffering. So if we say, no, it is impermanent, you see. We are really good together, but it is impermanent. We have to get ourselves ready to be departed. But as long as we are together, we will use this as the best way. Okay? So, like, many, many good points. And mostly, of course, I didn't practice in this, but when I face a big problem, I just always think of impermanent nature. The problems are so big, okay? Problems so big, and I start losing my hope. I started making myself almost like collapsing, you see. If I think that, oh, this is a big problem, but it is impermanent, okay? If I think this is a big problem, but it is impermanent, means it is changeable. Oh, I should not lose my hope. I really wanted to stand up and say, I really wanted to fight. It is impermanent, it is possible to change. And then I don't have to change just by only myself. Even the big problem, I can ask many of my friends, please help me, please help me. It's a big problem, but I have so many friends. And it is changeable. Wow, this is very good. It is changeable. It is not permanent. It is not so rigid. So good, okay. Oh, thank you. Thank you, permanent. It is changeable, okay. If it's a very bad thing, it is changeable. If it is a really good thing, also we have to be careful. Good thing can change into a very bad thing, you see. So, okay, I have to be very careful. So this is a real, you just think, okay. This is, for me, when I was childhood, this really made me survive. Thinking of impermanent really made me survive, and my family, my life at the age of 9, 10 was very difficult, very difficult. And worked very hard, baking food, and making food, fetching water, collecting wood, and I have to go under the tree, no mattress, just putting some brick and the food, my shoe, and that was my pillow for months. And I was almost like thinking that, okay, in Buddhism we talk about hell. So this must be hell, you see. Oh, sometimes I like, now I think I will collapse, almost losing hope. But then just, I don't know, it's because of my previous life or I heard something in Buddhism in this life, so everything is impermanent. Everything is impermanent, everything is changeable. Oh, I was very happy when I was in Tibet. It changed. Now I'm suffering. It will change. It will change. It will change. It will change. And started building hope in my mind, confidence in my mind. And of course, it changed. Therefore, just even this big, big problem, never give up. Never give up, okay? There's no problem which human being cannot solve, you see. The problem is we are not so focused. We are not putting so much effort, you see. And then, you know, no, just this. So to remove destructive emotions is possible because it's all impermanent, you see. And I think now it's enough. Any more questions? Yeah.
Last Friday, you talked a lot about anger and how it's very bad and how it destroys merit. And then Sunday, I got very angry with a friend of mine.
Huh?
I got very angry with a friend of mine on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
And
this Sunday?
Last Sunday, yes.
Oh.
And I tried to hide it from him as much as I could. And then I got really angry at me for getting angry with him. And this person I get angry with often, mm-hmm. hide it. Do I leave this person? How do I stop? I just was so upset with myself.
Mm-hmm.
For being angry with him, it was just this big circle of anger.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And after I'd already listened to your teaching, I just wonder what.
I hope that was not the production of my teaching. It's just joke, okay? Sorry. And again, in Chandidevas text, I think it is in the sixth chapter. If you are very, very angry, okay, towards someone who you are staying together and we meet time to time very often, and here he says that when you are very, very angry, what you can do is that you just think yourself as a rock or like a tree and neither think nor speak nor act, okay? Just remain yourself as like a rock in the sixth chapter, okay? Tezi shingshin nebarcha, that's the godi tingimidu. Tezi shingshin nebarcha. You just remain yourself like a tree, okay? Don't speak, don't act, okay? And don't think, just remain like a rock or wood, okay? Wood, okay? And then it will make little bit, it will make little down. If you sit like this, like 10 minutes or 15 minutes, it will go down. And then you breathe in and out, breathe in and out. Just your focus is just only on breathing in and out. Breathing in and out, breathing in and out, okay? If someone is shouting, it's okay. Don't pay any attention. Don't listen, okay? Of course, you might hear, but don't pay attention. In the mind, there's one mind which is called Nangla Menge. Nangla Menge means even you hear, but you don't remember. Yeah, Nangla Menge. That is very important, okay? And then anger goes down. Breathe in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. And then when anger is almost like not existing, and then you analyze how bad, how destructive, okay? And then you analyze, okay? Yeah? But during the, when you are very angry, don't speak anything. Yeah? Especially don't speak, okay? And don't act. Thought might not be able to stop, but don't act and don't speak. Why? Because if you speak, you will make a lot of mistakes. And if you hit, you will hit in the wrong place. Because your mind is so unstable, you see, very unstable. Yeah, very unstable because of the biased mind. So therefore, a first step is if you are very, very angry towards someone, you just remain yourself as a rock. I'm saying exactly according to this teaching, okay? Rock or tree, remain. Or don't speak, don't talk, and don't act. Because if you act, speak, you will make, definitely you will make mistake. And it will multiply the problem, okay? Just stay like, okay, you wanted to act, you wanted to speak, but try to control yourself. And then after that, if it's a little bit better, then you breathe in and out. This will make a lot of difference. And then you can analyze. But please try to analyze, okay, what will happen? Why did I get angry? What mistake he made? And what did I make? And I think normally you will find that there's no concrete reason to be angry, see? And it is pointless. And that anger has no good point which we can say that this is so precious, I can use all my life. There's nothing like this. Always make mistake, lead us to very bad situation. So and then the main thing is try to see the anger as very bad, okay? Very bad, okay. This is one of the things which destroyed me. Okay, I'm not going to establish any friendship with this. Means Buddha saw the destructive emotion as an enemy, but not the person who has destructive emotion. See the difference, you see? You see? So destructive emotion, we should not establish any friendship because it will destroy us. If someone is like an enemy, like human being, enemy, if we try to be nice, one day we become a really good friend. It is possible. But with the destructive emotion, if we disturb friendship, it will make worse and worse, worse, okay? All these drug addicts, it's like this. They started making friendship with the drug, attachment towards drug. The They use, and then totally ruined. Now, yeah, it's okay. Yeah, yeah. When I was angry, because I think I didn't use this thinking myself as a rock or tree. That I think I didn't. At that time, I didn't know. I know something from this thought transforming, like Lojong teaching. So from that, I try to meditate. Of course, I read this sixth chapter, but I was not so. My understanding was not so good. Not still, of course, it's not good. But that time, yeah. Luckily, I met a very good teacher. The senior tutor of Isolen Dalai Lama. He gave us a teaching of thought transforming for about 8 days, full day, 8 days. That was like, really, that was very good. Just looking to him, and he's so big, okay? So big and so shining and so much sort of like smiling and so, and then that made me so, like, relaxed, you see. And he's teaching. And at the time, he was just looking to me, okay? I was quite close to there. He was almost like looking to me, saying that you have to reduce your anger. Almost like, but it was my perception. Now, I think he's saying to me, so now I have to take the responsibility, see? So, there were many good coincidences, yeah. But still it took about 11 years. And still I have anger, okay? I have anger. Yeah, I get angry. But maybe a little better. Oh. Till my anger, I talked a lot. So now I think I have to, really I have to reduce this talking, because most of my friends, they heard this several times. Okay, now time is finished. Okay, I'll say thank you. And look, what I talk today is a small part of the eighth chapter, okay? And please don't say that Geshe-la taught us eighth chapter. So it just touched only a small part of it. But I thought, okay, instead of like touching all things, I thought better to touch one thing which is more sort of detail, okay? And therefore, we learn something from eighth chapter, that is okay. Geshe-la give some teaching from the eighth chapter, that is okay. Don't say that we finished all eighth chapter. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, thank you.